Rock music is always being attacked. For the uneasy air of money-making that surrounds it, for the pretentiousness of some of its lyrics, and for the shoddiness of some of its music. There is the suspicion that most pop musicians are so incompetent that they have to hire session men to make their records. While the faceless session men only get a standard fee, the pop artist makes a fortune. And all those who want to sneer yet again at long-haired youth are given a cheap thrill. There are some rock performers, however, who did have a severe classical training, which they ultimately found to be stifling and destructive. The only way to express what they wanted in musical terms was to escape into pop music. Such a person is Jack Bruce. Whilst the Cream were last in America, that is several haircuts ago, we asked Bruce what formal music training he had and if it had been of any use.
I did music at school and then I went to college in Scotland. But I got thrown out of it. But really, it's taken me up until about 2 years ago to unlearn what I had learned, you know. I wasn't making it, you know, until I really managed to unlearn the things that they'd taught me, you know. I really feel strongly that they just teach the wrong things, you know. They teach everyone the same things, you know, regardless of what their own individual capacities and so on are. They don't seem to take the trouble to find out people's individual characteristics, you know. And improvisation, things like that, it's regarded as really bad. They had great hopes for me as a cellist, you know. And they kept telling me that I couldn't write things, you know. So this was one particular teacher that I had. I used to write when I was 14. I wrote a string quartet and I proudly took it to her. And she instantly sort of wrote all over it and pointed out all the mistakes, you know. And it took me about a year at least to get over that, you know. And she used to tell me that I just couldn't write. I didn't have any talent for it. And I should make myself a good cellist, which I had talent for. I think she thought maybe I could be good enough to become sort of fourth desk in the Scottish National Orchestra or something, you know.
Though you despise the classical training you got at school, did it have no influence on you at all?
The first thing that really gathered me up was Bach, I suppose. You know, I got really involved in that because he, believe it or not, he is really the ultimate in bass players, you know. He really was the governor of all time, you know. His bass lines are just incredible, and I think any bass player can learn just about everything in conventional harmony that there is to know from that.
How did the Cream come together as a pop group?
Well, all of us were working in separate groups, and I don't think any of us was very happy with what was happening at the time. And I had played with Ginger for a long time, and we'd fallen out, actually, and I hadn't seen him for about a year. And he suddenly appeared at my place one night with this idea of forming a group with Eric. It just seemed such a good idea that we decided to have a play together just to see if it would work. And we all went to Ginger's house and we just set up our instruments in his living room and just played this number, which lasted for about 2 hours or something, you know, without stopping. And it was just so obvious that from the word go that it was going to be, you know, a nice experience. And that was it. The songs that we play are really unimportant. They're just like jumping off points for improvisation, and the only things that are set are the beginnings and the endings of most of our things. In between, which can go on forever, is just improvised, and we never know who's going to take the lead and what's going to happen next. It just happens, you know, depending on the atmosphere and the way we feel. And we never plan any particular song for any particular purpose. We wouldn't dream of sitting down and saying, let's write a hit single, for instance. Let's make it 2 minutes and 35 seconds long. Let's make the words, sort of sympathetic to an 11-year-old girl in Seattle or something. We just don't do that, and I suppose groups must. In fact, I was in a group once that did, you know, and did actually consider every song that they did from this point of view, you know, but we just don't. And the fact it was successful is, I suppose, an accident.
As Bruce says, their music is improvised. After a basic harmonic and rhythmic pattern is established, The melody is one of free improvisation. It often goes on for 20 or 30 minutes, but is held together by Bruce's flowing, spontaneous bass line. Bruce is also an expert on Indian music, and considers the influence of Indian music, its melodic freedom, its drones, its rhythmic complexity, to be rock's most substantial contribution to Western music. Just as in Indian music, the tabla player or drummer will talk to the sitar player with recognizable sound patterns, so rock music, like the Creams, has developed similar patterns. For Jack Bruce, his harmonica, his voice, and his pounding guitar speak with one voice of unmistakable clarity and power. The electronic guitar is also dismissed as nothing but a jangling noise machine, incapable of subtlety or delicacy. Lead guitarist Eric Clapton has built his reputation as a blues player on just these qualities, subtlety and delicacy. He explains, for example, how his guitar has four primary controls, controls for volume and controls for tone quality.
Those two are the volume. This one is for that pickup, and that one is for that pickup. And this is the tone for that pickup, and this is the tone for that pickup. And just by, you know, turning them all off or turning them all on, you can get a completely different sound. You know, you just get... And you get it very, very thin, like this. It's what you play when you've done that makes a difference, you know, because you can play...
What do you mean by that?
Well, you know, just the amount of pressure you put on with the flat pick, you know, because you can hit the strings very hard or hit them very soft, you know, or just touch them at any volume. You see? Now I can play that at the same volume, but softer.
The sound that's characteristic of electric guitars is the wah-wah effect that you make with the pedal.
I have to kick this to start it.
Could you play some and explain how it's done?
As I rock the pedal, you can hear it through the amplifier. As I rock the pedal, it takes bass off and puts treble on, you see, like that. So in actual fact, your volume isn't going down very much, but the tone is going wah, wah, like that.
Another characteristic of your particular playing is a kind of whining noise, usually described as woman tone.
Yeah, let me turn this thing off.
Can you tell us what that is?
The woman tone is produced by using either the bass pickup or the lead pickup, but with all the bass off. And in fact, if you use both pickups, you should take all the bass off on the tone control. That is to turn it down to one or O, you know, on the tone control, and then turn the volume full up. You know, and it's supposed to sound like this. The kind of blues I play I started playing was one of accompaniment, you know, of lead accompaniment. So that is quite difficult, you know. There are basic things that you'd have to learn about that style itself, which is the finger vibrato that you have to use, which is like that, you know. Which is very important.
Could you just do that again?
Yeah. You see, that itself is very difficult, can take you a long, long time to play and get that perfected.
When you're improvising, do you use stock phrases as the raw material? And if so, can you share some?
Yeah, there are phrases that I always play that are stock phrases that I work from, you know, which are just like... All these runs, you know, are put together from old phrases that I first started on, like... Now they're just all kind of messed up with other things which I learned like that, you know, which is... If a guy likes playing football, then that's what he'll use to get all of his kind of basic kind of angry bits out of him, you know, that you build up through any day, you know. You can just, like, someone will toot the horn in the car behind you and you'll get angry and you'll have no release for it, you know. Well, that happens to everybody, but you know, like... I've got the advantage of being able to sort of play that out on the guitar by being sort of fairly aggressive in the way I play, not the way I use it. That can be done too, you know, with people like The Who.
Can you show us?
And Pete Townsend. What do you mean? You want me to break the guitar up?
Well, no, not quite. Just an example of aggression in your music.
Yeah, right.
Must be particularly saddening for the drummer, Ginger Baker, since it was he, as Jack Bruce said earlier, who persuaded the other two to combine their differing talents in a trio whose virtuosity has staggered the musical world. It was also Ginger Baker who enabled the other two to develop their free-form playing. His playing is fragmentary, but insistent, devious, but relentless, meandering, but precise. To Jack Bruce's counterpoint, he gives rhythm, and to Eric Clapton's technical virtuosity, he gives shape. On their first tour together, he practiced so intensively that he left behind him a trail of hotel bills for broken furniture. We asked him if he still practiced as much.
No, it's not. I don't practice at all.
Not at all?
I used to, but I don't anymore.
In the distant days when you used to practice, what kinds of things did you do?
I just used to... First of all, I learned all the rudiments and things. I don't know whether I can play them all now, but... And then I just used to play solos. I used to just sit on the drum kit and play it all day.
Okay, if you were going to teach me drumming, what kind of rudiments would I have to learn? Presumably they're the same basic rhythms from which you improvise all your drumming. Can you show us some?
Well, I use quite a lot of them. Flam triplets, that sort of thing. You want me to play them?
Please.
At this time of day.
Variation of that would presumably depend on which drums you played it on.
Because that, you know, if you're playing them on tom-toms, you get two sounds out of it. Yeah. You get all sort of things like that out of a flam triplet. You
know. Yes, sound as well as rhythm.
So it starts off on a rudiment. Usually, I just forget all about them.
Show me another rhythmic pattern whose tone you can also vary by using different drums.
Four-stroke rough, which is... Yeah, but you're playing them around the drum, you get... Keeper, I think, it's my left foot. Keep time with that.
You mean hitting the bass drum?
Play, sort of, like, if you're using two bass drums, if you play a time with one, you can fill in with the other one, and it makes a pattern, the two of them together.
Can you show us?
Yeah. It's very odd, you know, and it's just sitting here doing it.
Presumably, you can also make endless rhythmic patterns just with your feet.
A foot one? Yeah, well, Say you're keeping time here, right?
Remarkable things about your playing is the way you manage to get a kind of dialogue going between your feet and your hands. Not only are your feet each playing different rhythms, but so are your hands, and that, of course, doesn't account for the cymbals. It's like a one-man orchestra.
Yeah, you can get good things right on a cymbal. Right.
Can you give us an example of this kind of instrumental conversation?
You can. Changing things, change the time of it by what you play on it with your left hand.
You got nine different kinds of cymbals. Can you tell us what each is for?
Yeah. These two, in fact, these three are all Roy cymbals, all for playing on. And just different sounds. I use that one for quieter things, this one, you know. That's a quieter cymbal. And this one. I use this one most of the time as a ride cymbal, you know. I use these two together to get a roll on them, and these and that on there. So you get a big roll on them. Over again. At the end of numbers, you can use that if you want to get a roll on cymbals, those two, you know. That's a crash cymbal. Very light cymbals. It's like those three are crashes. And these three are playing on. And that's, of course, a joke effect.